So welcome everybody to the Newton 1665 Web Seminar Series. Today we have three speakers, and all of them will be speaking about higher derivative theories and possible applications to the quantum gravity problem. The first speaker will be Alessandro Strumia, and then there will be a talk by Marco Piva, and finally by Philip Mannheim. So I will let the first speaker start now. Alessandro, please.
Okay, thank you. So as everybody knows, negative kinetic energy is called ghost because it cannot exist. But are we sure? So during lockdown, I had the free time to revisit this fundamental issue. Furthermore, webinars allow to speak without getting rotten tomatoes. So let me try. I will start easy from classical mechanics. If it fails, I close the seminar. Otherwise, I go to quantum mechanics. And next to classical field theory and possibly to quantum field theory. A paper will appear with Grossi, Teresi, and Zirilli. Motivation, if negative kinetic energy makes sense, you get the theory of quantum gravity because the graviton has dimension zero. So its most generic renormalizable action has four derivatives, which means R squared terms in the action. You invert the action, you get the propagator. It has four powers of momentum. You add the Einstein term, usual two powers of momentum, simple mathematics, this strange four derivative object is the difference between the normal graviton and something which must be a ghost because this minus means negative kinetic energy. So it's crucial to get the renormalizable quantum gravity. However, Ostrogradsky have shown that whenever you have more than two time derivatives, classical energy goes down to hell. And if there are interactions, then classical motion goes run away. That's why the G word makes physicists run away. Today, we will hear two attempts to quantize this theory as positive energy from Mannheim and Piva. I will discuss if negative energy, kinetic energy really is hopeless, or maybe it's similar to negative potential energy, which looks hopeless, but actually allows metastability up to cosmological times. Let's start. A simple exercise. Take this differential equation with four time derivative, put an interaction you like, solve numerically on a computer. If the coupling is large, it oscillates, but at some point it runs away. Bad. If the coupling is small, it oscillates and oscillates and oscillates and oscillates until you think it's tedious and you turn off the computer. In order to know if this oscillation goes up until cosmological time, you have to understand why it's not going runaway. And a useful step is rewriting a four derivative degrees of freedom as two derivative degrees of freedom. So the Hamiltonian is plus one harmonic oscillator minus a ghost harmonic oscillator and an interaction you like. And the energy is constant, but there are no extra constants of motion that prevent runaway. So what we expect that happens is that energies grow until they reach infinity while the total energy is conserved. However, if you try running in the computer, as I said before, this moves, but stays inside a well-defined region. So something good is happening. but only if the coupling is smaller. Otherwise, if the coupling is larger, this oscillates 1, 2, 3 times, but the next it goes crazy, run away. So we have to understand why this happens. And this mystery is well known, has been solved a century ago when physicists had no computers, but had a similar problem, understanding why the solar system is long-lived despite that energy conservation allows individual planets to escape. So Poincaré, Birkhoff, various names. You never heard, it's because this is written in old books covered by dust, and the same mathematics developed to understanding planets is what we need for ghosts. Even better, some real physical systems are ghosts. For example, this is the Sun, this is Jupiter, and this is the Lagrangian point L4, and this is the Hamiltonian of an asteroid around this point, written in the rotating frame where Jupiter is not moving. So you expand a quadratic plus interaction and you get a mass, you diagonalize, you get positive energy minus negative energy. The 2 degrees of freedom are the motion in the plane. So you check, asteroids are still there. Lot of garbage is present around the Lagrangian point L4, despite that it's a ghost. Another example, electron in the magnetic field gives a similar Hamiltonian because the Coriolis force is similar to the magnetic force, to the Lorentz force in the magnetic field. Another example of ghost. The mathematics is called Birkhoff series. So you have a classical Hamiltonian and somehow you want to diagonalize it, which means find the canonical transformation to action angle variables such that the Hamiltonian only depends on action, because then all actions are constants and motion is trivial. For a harmonic oscillator, this is the needed canonical transformation, but you want to compute some interactive theory. So if interactions are small, you do a perturbative computation, and this is what is called the Birkhoff series. Summarizing books in 2 lines, small coupling, the series is convergent, then planets do epicycle and stay, and ghosts stay. If coupling are large, the series is divergent, classical motion becomes chaotic, planets escape, and ghosts run away. So, in summary, a free ghost is good because it has no interaction that allow it to behave badly, but a weakly coupled ghost remains as good as a free ghost. In practice, when you compute, you have some leading order, you compute and you have something residual at higher order, you compute more and you have a residual at higher order. At some point you say too much, you stop and you have some residual. So let's try. This is the same example as before. This is the region in which ghost motion happens at leading order. If I go to first order, the region gets smaller. If I go to second order, it gets even smaller until ideally it shrinks to a point. And basically this shows that there is some sort of hidden integral of motion. But this only works if the coupling is small. If the coupling is large, nothing is convergent and you just get mass. So here we compute up to next leading order. At each order, we have a residual. We compute escape time due to this small residual. And the bound on the escape time is the highest of all the bounds. The series, the Birkhoff series, is asymptotic. So the bound is stronger for some finite value of the order, which depends on the coupling. And here is an example. On the horizontal axis is the coupling. Vertical axis is the time needed to ghost runaway. These are numerics. We cannot do too much with numerics. And this is the bound obtained analytically from Virchow series. The order that gives the dominant bound is 1, 2, 5, 6, 7, 16, and so on. So there are jumps, and these jumps happen because the Virchow series contains this sort of denominators with integers. If the denominator is accidentally big because of a cancellation, then you get something big even if the coupling is small, and this is called resonance. Now, if there are resonances, planets escape and ghosts run away even at small coupling. The worst possible resonance is at leading order, which means ghost and normal particle have the same frequency. To compute what happens, you have to study another old book with title Resonant Normal Forms. Basically, this book tells, diagonalize everything but the resonance. For example, we can compute this interaction. You do a lot of computations and you find something, 1 plus 1 half, and you realize that this means that this resonance is not bad. So let me show what happens in numerics. You start here and you let the system evolve. Since it's on the resonance, energies are growing a lot by a factor of order 1, but at some point they came back, remaining confined into a large but still finite region. So somehow it's like if the positive energy and the negative energy are still locked by the chain is loose. Different interaction allows immediate escape. And this will be relevant when studying field theory. So, summary of classical mechanics, ghosts can be metastable and they even exist in nature. This was easy because we just read old books written by smart old people. Now we have to get off from shoulders of giants and try to do by ourselves, hoping that we don't stomp on their graves, doing stupid things. Second, quantum mechanics. Here is again the same model with 1 degree of freedom with negative kinetic energy, and you put the same interaction. And this is the Schrödinger equation. It has an unusual sign due to the ghost. Because of this, energy minus potential energy no longer tells if the wave function oscillates or dumps. So what could go wrong is that any wave function could spread in the region where each energy is very large, but total energy is small. Then the wave function could oscillate, go very far up to run away. To see if this happens, let's use brute force. We compute numerically the bound state, and this is the wave function squared. So basically, around the origin, it's a free particle, Gaussian, as it should be for trivial reasons. Next, far from the origin, some mass happens, but this mass is exponentially suppressed. So the outflowing probability current that tells the stability time is very small. And overall, this is much like a normal particle, 2 positive kinetic energy, 1 negative kinetic potential, sorry, 1 negative potential energy. This gives instability, called potential instability. Kinetic energy instability behaves much like in the same way, at least away from resonance. Why? Tunneling can be approximated semi-classically in this way. the Schrödinger equation becomes the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is a classical equation. S is the classical action. So whatever good properties of classical theory, they are still doing something useful indirectly in quantum mechanics. Now the hidden integrals of motion still play a role and keep the wave function close to the origin. This is good, but to be honest, I have to tell one nasty detail that we don't understand yet. The WKB approximation is useful because when you have many, many, many degrees of freedom, it allows to compute much simpler than Schrödinger. Schrödinger tells, compute the wave function, and if there are many variables, 1, 2, 3, 4, it's a mess. Hamilton-Jacobi is another differential equation, but it's a wave equation indirectly related to particle motion, classical. So at the end, you just need to find the classical trajectory that goes through the barrier in the simplest possible way, and you get the vacuum decay rate. So this is why WKB computationally is much simpler than Schrödinger. However, Hamilton-Jacobi has a square because Hamiltonian has momentum square. So there are two solutions with opposite sign of this action. And let's compute, for example, without interactions. Normal particle, normal stuff. This factor is the classical action at infinite Euclidean time. Ghost, to be normalizable, needs classical motion, but backwards in time. Now we have to go to negative Euclidean time. Okay, the problem is that if you put interactions, I can no longer go in both directions, and then I lose WKB as a tool to compute efficiently. And unfortunately, this will be needed for doing quantum field theory. But for the moment, let's do classical field theory. I would like to do graviton and ghost, but for simplicity, I do one scalar with positive energy minus another scalar with negative energy and some interaction. Let me remind that classical field theory is sick even without ghosts, because it wants to equipartition energy among infinite modes, and this gives the usual black body divergence solved by quantum mechanics. So ghost is a comorbidity of this theory. If something goes wrong, you have to diagnose if something bad happens because of the ghost or with the ghost. Anyhow, classical theory is good because we can compute either numerically on the lattice or analytic. We expand the field as Fourier modes and we apply Birkhoff to all the Fourier modes. So let's do analytically. Off-shell interactions, no problem, no runaway. The new problem is that when you have lots of modes, they have lots of frequencies, and then you get lots of resonances. As we have seen, resonances are bad, and these resonances, in normal language, are just the usual decays and scatterings of the theory. So let's compute. We take the interaction, we decompose it into Fourier modes, we open the book about resonant normal forms, we compute something, result, it's a benign resonance. It does not allow immediate runaway, but still energy can flow by order one. Now, this is the same we found when we had the 2 degrees of freedom. Now, we do free theory. In the continuum limit, there are infinite degrees of freedom. There are infinite resonances. So if each resonance allows a bit of energy exchange, infinite resonance allow energy flow between positive and negative energy. Pictorially, too many ghosts can escape from lockdown because the chain that keeps them is loose, so they escape. Something good is happening, but seems not good enough. Bit ambiguous situation. So let's compute more, assuming the worst possible case, mass winds, runaway is possible, and then entropy decides what happens. Entropy is maximal when the temperature of positive energy is infinity and temperature of negative energy is minus infinity. Intuition of what will happen is that there is a ghost with negative temperature. Not ghost temperature must be negative because temperature is the average of energy, which is negative. The ghost wants to thermalize with the normal field with normal positive temperature and have the same temperature, but this is impossible because one is positive and the other is negative. So what happens is that heat keeps flowing forever and entropy decides the direction of this heat flow, and the direction is such that both temperatures go to plus or minus infinity. Very bad to see how fast let's solve classical Boltzmann equations of statistical mechanics, which by the way are valid even beyond the thermal limit. And let me open a parenthesis. To write classical Boltzmann equations, it's good to start from quantum Boltzmann equations because they are well known, at least for positive energy. So let's assume here positive energy. You write the Boltzmann equations, you find that they contain the Bose-Einstein at equilibrium. You know, it's the usual statistical factors that I suppose you know. The classical limit is occupation number much bigger than one. You expand the quantum equation in this limit, you get the classical equation, and then you can compute the thermalization rate between two positive energy fields with different temperatures. You get analytic result, and it agrees with numerical result on lattice. So next, we can compute the ghost. The only new thing,
Sandro,
is that
kinematics. I think you have 5 minutes.
Okay. Kinematics allows negative energy, and this is unusual. But one can call emission of negative energy, you call it absorption of positive energy, and kinematics becomes standard. And this step is useful because the statistical factor Bose-Einstein satisfies this identity that tells that everything in the Boltzmann equation remains the same. So at the end, there is a very simple result, no thermal equilibrium, and the heat flow rate between ghost and normal particle is the same heat flow rate as between two different fields. This means that the rate is coupling squared. It's not exponentially suppressed, and analytics somehow agrees with dirty numerics. This is an example of time evolution. Now you start from here. Blue is the positive energy, red is negative energy. They evolve, and they slowly grow a bit, grow a bit, grow a bit, grow a bit, until bang, you get a runaway. Game over, not yet. Because I am interested in this four derivative gravity, where my ghost only has gravitational couplings, and nobody cares about gravitational couplings in cosmology, because they are so small that the rate is much smaller than the Hubble rate. So this happens, but only a tiny bit that is not doing anything, and inflation more or less is a sort of temperature. Finally, I have to do relativistic quantum field theory. Now, so far, the ghost is alive. I compute the rate for vacuum that goes into positive energy stuff and negative energy stuff. Since I studied too much, I start from the Boltzmann equation and I do the limit of zero temperature, and I get some rate. And this rate is what everybody would have immediately computed. It contains a divergent integral over the Lorentz group. And this integral must be there because the initial state, the vacuum, is Lorentz invariant. I assume the relativistic quantum field theory. And then the ghost production rate is infinite. So is infinite large enough that finally the ghost is excluded? Well, the same problem was encountered in all the computations of vacuum decay by Okun and others. So now I am talking about negative potential energy. People who first tried to compute it got the same problem. The critical bubble can be produced with any initial speed, so the rate was infinite. Furthermore, whenever you have negative potential energy, you can build a field configuration with negative mass. So anyhow, you have a ghost in the theory, even if you just have a negative potential energy. So does it mean that negative potential is excluded? Kahneman, as we know, argued that the answer is no. The rate of vacuum tunneling is exponentially suppressed by the action of the Lorentz invariant instanton that connects the two vacua, the so-called bounce. So finally, I don't know, maybe one possibility is that negative kinetic energy could be similarly exponentially suppressed. I don't know. Dvalli has doubts even on negative potential. Not everything in the Coleman argument is clear. Furthermore, I have a second difficulty. Coleman used the WKB as a simple tool to extend quantum mechanics to quantum field theory, but this simple tool, I don't have it. For ghost, so far I would have to do a brute force computation to see what the result is, and I have not yet done it. So, conclusions. What is the answer to this question? In classical mechanics, ghosts are good, they even exist, but you need to stay at small coupling and avoid resonances. Classical field theory is bad, but the ghost I like only has gravitational coupling, and this bed is so slow that it's not a problem. Quantum mechanics seems fine. Quantum field theory, I don't know. Sorry. So, final slide. What is the answer to the question in the title? Not yet measured, but comes out from the computation is a less dangerous animal than expected. Ghosts are not so bad. However, lockdown is over. I have not yet finished the computations. We only get the back well computed, and it smells very good. It's quiet, but could get wild and kick. I don't know. So there is something to be done in the future. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Alessandro. Are there any questions or comments? I don't see any.
Everybody's shocked there.
Hello?
Yes?
May I ask a question to speak?
Sure.
Yeah, I just wonder if you tried about classical solutions, if you tried multi-scale approach, which is the standard approach for. But this is standard approach when standard perturbation theory fails, like in planet's orbit. Actually, it was first studied for that. And another example is the nonlinear pendulum.
So I think I already understood the classical theory enough. No, it's a ghost can be stable. That's I believe this is the totally final answer. I don't need to do it better.
Okay.
No, the real problem for me is in the relativistic quantum field theory.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Other questions or comments?
I want to ask a question. So,
sure, please.
As you described that, okay, your title of the talk is "Ghost is okay or not." I want to ask a different question. Like, okay, Ghost may be okay if you fine tune the parameters. Is fine tuning is okay or not? I mean, from well, what I have in mind is quantum gravity perspective. Like, is the fine tuning okay? I mean, like, let's say if you have a good quantum gravity with fine tuning, and if you have different parameters, if the theory goes bad, then is it a good theory? That's my question.
So the claim is that whenever you have small couplings, like this sort of gauge-like couplings of gravity. Whenever couplings are small, then ghosts are good, at least in classical theory. So I don't know if they are good up to the end. You need the small couplings, and the small couplings are not fine-tuned. No, it's just a small coupling.
Yeah, but for example, F2 has to be much smaller than F0. Am I correct?
They can be comparable. They just have to be both smaller.
Okay, but then the ghost will be same. Will have the same mass as the like scalar we have in the theory.
Will be two states with comparable mass, and one of them is a ghost. No, the other I ignored because it's not a ghost.
Then is it okay that theory is healthy or not?
So as far as I know, no, in classical physics, so it's healthy, possibly unless in relativistic quantum field theory, which of course is the theory we really care about. This one, there is hope that it's good, but one needs to compute.
Okay.
So, Alessandro, I have a confusion. So you mentioned this relation between the unstable potential and the existence of a ghost. Okay.
Yes.
But there must be a difference between ghost and unstable potential. So what is it? Otherwise, I mean, otherwise you could just really say, okay, I take Coleman and that's it.
No, okay. First, no, I cannot say I just take Coleman because I don't know how to compute. So maybe now the ghost kicks back in some different way. Furthermore, even in Coleman, there is a doubt about this kind of issues.
No, but about the first statement, I mean, this configuration, which are ghost bubbles, for example, but do they exist as asymptotic states, for example? You could just say that the ghost and the potential instability is the same thing, but I don't think that's the case.
They expand, so it's not really the same thing, but as I told, there are many papers that study this issue, which is somehow similar. Okay, it's not the same, I agree. But somehow it's similar. So if it is not yet fully clarified in the simpler case, a fortiori, I suffer.
Okay. So I would propose to move to the next speaker because it's already 15:34.